This game is entirely controlled by a machine learning model. I've let it play the game multiple times and it ended up learning how to score points by itself. We call this approach reinforcement learning, and we'll go through all the steps to make a model that can play this game or even other games. I'll first explain the problem that we will solve. Reinforcement learning comprises two main components: the environment, in this case a 2D game, and the agent, here a spaceship in that game. The agent interacts with the environment by moving around and firing projectiles. It obtains rewards that indicate how good its actions are. If the agent collects a point or hits an enemy, it obtains a positive reward. If it gets blasted by an enemy, it obtains a negative reward. Our goal is to maximize the rewards to make the agent as good at playing as possible. By the way, you can try the game out if you want. Open up the project in GitHub, clone the repository on your machine, install the dependencies, and run the game. Let's now have a look at the models that we can use. A basic model for reinforcement learning is the Q table. Q stands for quality, which is an estimation of the future rewards that an agent can obtain for a given state and action. A Q table looks like this. The rows represent all possible states of the environment, and the columns represent the possible actions that an agent can perform. Each cell contains a Q value. Actions that are more likely to lead to rewards are given a higher Q value. For instance, in this state, moving towards the collectible is more likely to result in a future reward than moving away from it. So, moving in this direction corresponds to a higher Q value. When playing the game, the agent can look up the Q table to perform the action with the best quality, given some state of the environment. Q tables are easy to understand, but often impractical. Before using them, they have to be filled by performing each action in all possible states of the environment and determining the corresponding Q values. That works for simple environments, but for more complex problems, we may have to try millions of states and actions to fill a Q table. This approach would not work well in these cases, but we can improve it. Instead of using a large table, we can approximate it with a machine learning model. This is called deep Q learning. The model will not memorize all possible states and actions like a Q table, but will rather learn patterns from interactions with the game to estimate which actions are more likely to result in rewards. This is more scalable than a Q table because it can generalize to unseen states, making it more suitable for complex environments. We will use an artificial neural network for this approximation model. As the name tells, neural networks are made of individual neurons, like this one. It's a mathematical model that takes one or multiple values as inputs, multiplies each input by a weight, sums the weight in inputs along with a bias term, and applies a mathematical operation to the result. This operation is called the activation function, and it's used to make the neuron model more complex patterns. An example of a simple but widely used activation function is the rectified linear unit, which cancels negative values. The training process modifies the parameters of the neuron, that is, its weights and bias, to make it learn how to play the game. A single neuron is pretty limited, but we can create more complex patterns by connecting neurons into a neural network. These networks are often organized into layers of neurons that take the information from the previous layer and transmit it to the next layer. In our case, the first layer of the network, the input layer, receives footage from the game. The final layer, the output layer, decides which button to push. This is used to control the agent on the screen. Between these, we can add hidden layers, which help the network learn complex patterns from the input. We can change the number of hidden layers, the number of neurons in each layer, and the way that the neurons are connected. All of these changes are examples of hyperparameters, which are settings that define the architecture of the model. In theory, we could simply flatten the input image into a 1D vector and feed it to a layer of neurons. This model is called a multi-layer perceptron. It's a good approach for many problems, but multi-layer perceptrons often struggle with images because they lack spatial awareness. They treat the pixels of the image as unrelated, separate entities, which is not effective. In practice, if you want to understand an image, you have to look at collections of pixels to recognize particular features, like shapes or edges. We can do that with convolution, a mathematical operation where a small grid, the kernel, slides across the image to detect features. For instance, a solvable operator is a type of convolution that highlights edges. In our model, the convolutional layer will extract relevant features to recognize collectibles and enemies from the input. The next stage is a fully connected layer. The features extracted by the convolutional layer are flattened into a one-dimensional vector and fed to all neurons of that layer. During training, the parameters of the neurons will be adjusted to decide which actions must be performed depending on the detected features. Finally, we can plug the fully connected layer to the output. this neural network can be written with the following PyTorch code. The network will probably not be very good at playing because it is pretty shallow, meaning that it doesn't have many layers. Research has shown that increasing the depth of a network, that is, increasing its number of layers, can improve its performances. But we have to be careful not to add too many layers, because we then run the risk of overfitting the model, which means that it will memorize specific examples seen during training instead of developing a general understanding of the game. Let's summarize. We want to train a reinforcement learning agent that will learn to play the game. We can do that by filling a queue table and letting the agent look up the best action to take for any state. That table would be large and impractical, so we instead approximate it. This approach is known as deep queue learning, and the neural network that is used is called a deep queue network. The next step is to train this network. For now, its parameters are left at their default values. Here's what happens when we let the untrained model play. As expected, it performs poorly because it still hasn't learned the rules of the game. Here's how we'll train it. We create an environment and make the agent play. This is called an episode. Episodes are split in discrete steps, which are game frames. On each step, the model observes a 2D image from the game and predicts a queue value for all actions. In other words, it tries to guess the propensity of each action to lead to rewards. The agent then performs the action with the best queue value, which modifies the environment and may result in a reward. The agent collects the reward and observes the new state of the environment. The model then predicts the queue values for this new state and selects the highest queue value. This represents the future reward that the agent expects to obtain by performing this action in a subsequent step. We now add up the reward that the agent just collected with the future reward that it expects to obtain. This is called the Bellman equation. It estimates the quality of an action not just from the immediate reward, but also from the future rewards that it expects to get. Our goal is to make the model estimate the Bellman equation as well as possible to identify the actions that lead to the highest rewards. To do that, we want to minimize the difference between the Q value predicted before the action and the Q value calculated after performing the action and taking the reward into account. We call this difference the loss. The loss is propagated in the network in the inverse direction to compute gradients, which are, roughly speaking, values that indicate how the parameters need to be adjusted to minimize the loss. The process that computes gradients is called backpropagation. We then use the gradients retrieved during backpropagation to adjust the parameters of the network with a process called gradient descent. This makes the model slightly better at approximating the Bellman equation. Steps are repeated until the episode ends, either by losing or reaching the maximum number of steps. Once the episode ends, a new one begins, and the process continues until the model approximates the Bellman equation to our satisfaction. This graph shows the performances of the model over its training. The x-axis shows the number of episodes, and the y-axis shows the average score obtained by the agent when we evaluated between episodes. The model gradually improves, but its performances are very unstable. We can improve the training process to stabilize and enhance the performances of the model. Here are the five main improvements I've added. First improvement, add randomness during training. This is called exploration. We choose actions that the neural network would not have otherwise selected on its own. That way, the model experiments a wider variety of actions, and it becomes better at approximating the queue table. Exploration contrasts with exploitation, which is when we use the action selected by the network instead of picking a random one. We start by relying mostly on exploration, and as the network becomes better at selecting the right actions, we gradually use more and more exploitation. Second improvement, downsize the input. Raw game footage looks pretty small for a human, but it still contains more than 65,000 pixels for each frame. The neural network needs a lot of parameters to process them, so it can simply downsize the image. The network now needs fewer parameters and becomes easier to train. Third improvement, combine frames. The current model looks at a single frame to decide which action to perform, so it has a hard time understanding the motion of objects. We can instead give it multiple frames. That way, it will be able to figure out the direction of projectiles and collectibles. Fourth improvement, increase depth. As we've seen, adding hidden layers in the neural network makes it better at processing data, provided that you don't add too many. I've added two convolutional layers. That will improve performances without leading to overfitting. Fifth improvement, experience replay. Right now, the model is trained in consecutive steps, which are highly correlated. This is not ideal because the network might overfit to these observations. Instead, we can store the observations in an experience buffer and let the model sample random observations from the buffer when performing backpropagation and gradient descent. That way, it is exposed to a varied set of experiences, which improves its ability to generalize. Let's recap. We trained a reinforcement learning model to play a game by itself. The model is a deep Q network that predicts which actions are more likely to result in rewards, and the agent uses the predictions to score points. We improved our initial model by using exploration, modifying the input data, increasing depth, and using experience replay. These improvements stabilize the training process and result in a more efficient model. The training process is not perfect though, and in some cases, the network does not learn how to play well. For instance, it may end up learning to just hide in a corner and spam the fire button. This is called a local optimum. It's not the best strategy overall, but if the network is not exposed to a varied set of experiences during its training, it may learn the strategy at some point and then stick to it instead of exploring other, potentially better solutions. To further improve the model and avoid local optima, we could, for instance, use a more advanced model, like a dual-link Q network or recurrent neural network, optimize the rewards obtained by the agent to prioritize long-term goals and penalize repetitive actions, or adjust the hyperparameters of the model to improve training. There's a lot more to reinforcement learning than what I've laid out in this video, so let me know if you'd like to see more. Also, I encourage you to read these papers if you want more information on reinforcement learning. Playing Atari with deep reinforcement learning covers the architecture of deep Q networks and their training process. Deep learning goes over the fundamentals of neural networks, including backpropagation and gradient descent. ImageNet classification with deep convolutional neural networks presents a deep learning model for image classification and explains convolutional layers. Everything required to play the game and replicate the training is at my GitHub repository. Training the model might take some time, especially if you don't have a compatible GPU, but I've also made a simpler game that takes much less time to train, so you can try it even on less powerful systems. Don't hesitate to check it out.